got a good field of vision going. And there it goes. Transition. Bam. Hi, everybody. I'm here. Right. That's much better. Excellent. So here we are. I am Sai. This is a stream for Unravel and Unwind. It's Tuesday Hangout, and we are in my home studio today. And today we are going to be playing, but first, of course, the beverage. Dun, dun, dun. I'm gonna confess something to you guys right now, and I'm gonna put it right up there. Look at that. Ooh, so you can see me. I'm going to confess that I have done something that might just be evil, really evil. Okay, I've mixed tea and coffee in the same mug. I'm just gonna give you a second to ruminate on that. I'm drinking it. I'm still smiling. It can't be that bad. It's interesting. I was making a coffee in my coffee press, and I just thought, you know what? I'm gonna add some praline flavored tea to that so that I can have praline flavored coffee. But actually, it's praline tea flavored coffee, but it's still good. So I consider that a win. And I used a very large mug. Look, it's the size of my head. And so, thirst quenched, it is time to move on. So, today, that's my mouse. Ooh. Today, I have got Heartfelt Creations matching stamps and dies. And I'm really proud of myself, can I just say? Because I've managed to fit, so far, all of my Heartfelt Creations stamp and die sets into a birch box. Ha! For those of you who don't know what birch box is, it's like a subscription box with like makeup and skincare and fun stuff. And they give you these very nice, high-quality boxes. And I can't bear to throw them away, but being a crafter, I have so many things that need organizing anyway that I am using my birch boxes. Good thing that's happened recently is the birch box has actually become a birch drawer. So there are boxes like this with lids and there are drawers. And I'm going to stack the drawers up and glue them together and go all mixed media on it and make it really awesome. But that's going to be sort of custom storage for other smaller pieces that are, you know, that would fit in a box this size. And I can just grab it and take it with me. I love this. And it was just, you know, a free sort of knock-on effect of something else I do. So I'm happy. Win-win. Yay me. Okay, so let's show you what's up with these. Now, this one is called the Botanical Rose. No, it's not. It's the Classic Rose set. I get confused, you know. And these are the dies that come with it. So they don't come with. You buy them separately. This is a stamp set, and it's got all these little, you know, rubber stamps on of flowers and leaves. And then on the back where I've put it, I've used a sticky backed magnetic sheet to stick it onto the stamp holding sheet. And I've got all of the dies that match the stamps. So if you look, you stamp the item and then you cut the design out and it matches exactly. So that is part of what we're doing today, is that we're going to cut them out. But beyond that, we are also going to be coloring and shaping them. It's gonna be fun. And because the weight of the paper recommended is different, the whole shaping process is actually different from what I normally do with ordinary copy paper. So yeah, blazing new trails, as it were. So I'll just show you what I've got. I've got this Classic Rose set, and I have this one, which is called Sun-Kissed Fleur. And the cool thing about this is all the stamps are on one die, or on one sort of stamp. And the die, which is supposed to be on the back there, and isn't, there it is. It's all one die as well. So you just crank it through the machine once and you've got all of those shapes done in one pass, which is a time saver. And this one I'm particularly happy about, very happy about. Because this is a design that I had a very hard time finding. And if you want to find it, if you get it on Amazon, it's going to cost you way over the odds at about £85. Too much money. And this set was limited edition and it is discontinued now. It's called Tattered Blooms or Tattered Blossoms, something like that anyway. And this one is still made in the Spellbinders colors. And this is the pink is the Heartfelt Creations colors. But these Tattered Blossoms, they don't sell anymore. I went directly to the manufacturer's site and they're gone. But someone was willing to sell theirs on eBay for a reasonable price, so I got them and I'm thrilled with them. These hadn't even been opened. The package was sealed. These came on a sheet, but they're just like new. So I'm very happy. I got them for what the ordinary sets cost new. I got these for. And they're being sold at a ridiculous premium elsewhere because they are discontinued. I'm happy though, I've got that. And a friend of mine has been decluttering her place and she found a set that she doesn't want anymore, so I'm getting another one. So excited. So anyway, let's keep these out of the box. Pardon me. Okay. So, next thing we need for this is we need our die cutting machine. I am using that. It is a Cuddlebug V2. It's cool. It's a nice one. If you're in the market for a full-size die cutting machine, this one is really nice. The reason that I like this one is because it doesn't take up a lot of space. It just folds up and you can just shove that onto a shelf. And even the handle folds in. You see, it comes up like that and then you swing, you know, like that. But even that folds right in and you don't have to worry about it. And when you pull out the cutting platforms to use it, it activates a suction thingy underneath it that's supposed to keep it quite straight, but here it is. It's like a suction thing, and if you put it on a hard surface, it does actually suck it right up down to the surface, which is great. It does not need to be because it's got this handle on the top. You hold that handle while you crank everything through, you're fine. So that's what we're going to be using to cut with. I'm going to fold it back up though. I've got my collection of plates and shims that I use with the machine, which I can explain, but I don't know if I need to. So let's do that in a minute. But for now, it is stamping time. So I'm going to go grab some paper. This paper over here I don't like. Let's see. Paper or card? Paper. I don't want paper. It shouldn't be this difficult to find paper. Oh dear. Silly. I guess I'll have to open a new pack. That's terrible. That's not it. Okay. This is what I use. It says that it's 160 GSM. Now, this is a very close approximation of the weight of the paper that they use. In America they do, and that's where the Heartfelt Creations is from. It's from America. They have a different system of paper weights than we do. We use GSM, which is grams per square meter, and they use something called, like they use pounds, right? And this is what I don't quite get, okay? This stuff, which I now have to try and open. Come here. Alright. This stuff is 160 grams per square meter. In America, they've got this stuff called 100 pound paper. And I think it's that a certain number of sheets of a certain size weighs 100 pounds or something like that. And that's why they call it that. But this is approximately that weight. I went and I looked at a conversion chart the other day, and it said that 100 pound text paper, which is this, they have two separate settings, one for text stock, one for cover stock. Text stock paper that's 100 pounds is apparently 147 GSM. So this isn't much thicker than what they were using, but we'll see. I do have something here that's a bit thinner, but I don't think I like the finish on it. It's a little bit waxy, and I don't know if that's going to help or hinder the process we're about to get into. So we'll see, shall we? Let's start with the 160, because that's what I use the most. And that's what I'm hoping is going to work. Okay, what else do I need for this? Hopefully that's all I need for this, because I think I've left all my other stuff somewhere else. I'm so prepared today, aren't I? I'm always so prepared. Okay, so let's have a look then. I want to start with the... No, I'll do the one, this big one. Whoops! I really should put some more metal on that, because it doesn't stick, does it? No, it's too heavy. It doesn't want to stick. Anyway, so we're going to use that die, and therefore we're going to use that stamp. All right, so I'll put my die over here for later. And then, you know what, I'm not even going to take this stamp off of this. I'm just going to use it on here. Mainly because all my stamp things are downstairs, because I had them at the studio yesterday. That's how organized I am. Okay, so let's have this vintage sepia VersaFine. There you go. Vintage sepia VersaFine ink. VersaFine ink is great. It's like an oil-based pigment ink, and it really picks up fine detail, which is why they call it VersaFine. So I'm going to just have a little ink it up. Always take your time when you're inking up a stamp. Last thing you want is for the stamp to not be inked to your satisfaction and you get a bad impression. So I'm just going to flip that right over. And I'm going to stamp it. I'm going to lay it down. The key to stamping a large image like this is to always keep one hand at least on the stamp and make sure that it doesn't hop anywhere. Okay, and make sure that you get pressure on all parts of the stamp. If you're worried about the surface that you're stamping onto, like this, you can get like a really thick, dense foam, and that'll make up for any uneven patches on your surface. So let's see. Hopefully this one's come out okay. Lift. Yeah, it has. Now that is fantastic. Looks great. I'm very happy with it. Okay, what's next? What's next is that I'm gonna have to cut this. I'm the only crafter in the world that doesn't have like a cutter thing. Okay, look, I've got my little cutter bee. I'll just use that, okay? There we go. I'm using my cutter bee. Normally I would have one of those slidey paper trimmers with me. I don't today, but you know what, whatever works. So, I've got that. I'm just gonna give it a minute because it is, VersaFine ink does take just a bit to dry. It's lovely. Okay, so we'll get out our cuddle bug and open out the platform. And then we need to put our plates on in the right order. So we need our A plate. That's the base plate. It's quite a thick plate. See, nice big thick base plate. We need A. And then because we are cutting, we need the C plate for wafer thin dies. Because there's all sorts of different thicknesses of die on the market, and these are considered wafer thin metal dies. And they don't have any padding within them at all. And then I've learned that I need a little bit extra padding on it. So I use a couple of sheets of card. One is the packaging from this Tesco card, and that's quite a good card to use, actually. Other card brands are available, but your cheapest option is actually that pack I just showed you that I took that card out of, which is actually from Hobbycraft. And we are affiliates of Hobbycraft. So if you go over to our website, which at the moment can be found at unravelandunwindcic.wordpress.com, click on the menu item that says places where we shop, and one of them is Hobbycraft. If you click on Hobbycraft through that site, we'll get a little kickback if you buy anything. So think of us next time you do your craft shopping. So I'm going to put these shims on here like this. All right, so after you've done that, then you put your... we have to position the die on the paper. So let's do that next. Can you see this? Let's swap angles here. There we go. You can see me now, right? So the good thing about this die, and they've redesigned them since the early days, the cutting edge is really, really close up here to, it is right on the actual edge of the die. Normally there's a space. I'll show you, these ones probably have a space. Yeah, look, do you see the lines? The lines are the cut lines. And there's this sort of gap here between the cut line and what you can see through the dies. So you need a positioning guide for these ones. But for these, you can just look right through them and make sure that they're positioned correctly. So that's what we're going to do next. Let me see if I can bring my camera down just a little bit so you can see what I'm doing. Here we go. Right. So now the cutting side has to go against, see the cutting side here? It's the ridgy bit. Has to go down, pointing into the paper like this. And then all you do is you position your cutting die so that it's going to cut on or near the lines, hopefully. There it is. It looks like I've got a good positioning on that now. And I'm just going to take a tiny little piece of tape. This is not the kind of tape you should use. But I'm going to use... I got this. It's okay. Okay, don't move. Don't move. I highly recommend you use Scotch tape. Oh, look, Scotch tape. I just saw some. Okay, I got it. Scotch tape or any low-tack tape. And just tape bits of this to the card, just so that as you roll it through the machine, it doesn't shift. Okay, there we go. All right, so I've got a couple bits of tape on there. Two should do it. And then what you do is you put that into the machine, cutting side up. And then you put your top plate on. That's the B plate. Mine is very creased, as you can see. It's been cut many, many, many times. And that's okay. You know, it'll still work. So that's your sandwich. A plate, C plate, shims, die, cutting side up, paper, top plate, right? It sounds complicated, but you just get used to it after a while. Right, so, sorry, I'm cranking it through now. And it is, I'm getting some resistance off the machine, which is good because that tells me that I'm gonna have a nice cut. And I do. Look at this. There you go. It's not exactly right. It's just a little bit off, but I like it. Let's see. So I think I should just be able to whack this and get my flowers out, yeah, for the most part. Right. So let's just put those down there. I'll get this out of the way. And we'll just keep popping them out. Now, when the when this comes out, you can just take the tape off. If you're going to be cutting a lot, I recommend that you just leave the tape on so that you can position the next one. Right, so that's that. Excellent. So we've got some bits here now. Okay. Okay, the next step. Now that we've got all our flowers cut in one swift pass of the machine, our next thing is to color these flowers in. Now, what's recommended is to color them in with chalk ink and a sponge dauber. So let me just grab my chalk ink. Ah, this might be a good opportunity, actually. Yeah, I think I'm going to do this. I love this pad. I don't use it very often, and as a result, it is probably drying out. This is a ColourBox Petal Point Fluid Chalk Pad. And the good thing about this one is, it is a very large pad with lots of different colors in it, but you can take each individual piece out and use it on its own. If you want, of course you could, you know, ink a whole big stamp on it, but I don't like to do that. So let's get inking then. What color should we use? I quite like this one and that one. So is that blue? What is that? That's ice blue. This is dark peony, orchid pastel, wisteria, warm violet, lavender, blue iris, and Prussian blue. So there's nice options there for us. I think I'll go for the purpley ones though. Maybe these three here. And we'll see what we get from it, because I do like the iris color as well. So let's start with a dark color, I guess. You're supposed to start with light colors. Let's start with light colors. Right, so I think if you look at this flower, the lines on it are an indication of what's a darker area and what's a lighter area. And I would say that this area with the less lines on it is probably a lighter area of the flower, because that's probably where the light would reflect off of it. So you can't really see a lot of color coming off of this. It's because these pads are old, but the thing I like about old ink pads is that you can just use them as sponge daubers, because there's not a lot of ink left on them, and the ink blends quite well. So I'm enjoying that. Tip of the pad is quite good as well to get into small areas. But this is just the light bit. I'm going to try one whole flower with the different colors before I start repeating myself. So I'm going to put this one back in, and I'm going to go with a slightly darker one, which is the wisteria. And I'm going to color that. I'm just going really gently with the point at the moment onto the inner bits of the flower. It's gone quiet. Sigh's gone quiet. Something must be wrong in the universe. I will hold this closer up in a minute so that you can see it. But if you've got nice, fresh, juicy pads, then you're going to want to get yourself some sponge daubers from a craft shop. So that's what I've got. I'm sort of angling it away from my craft light so that you can see the colors. Right, so we've got a slightly darker color towards the middle, and I'm going to go even darker at the tips of the petals for some contrast. I'm going to use the warm violet. May have to get me some more of these, actually. But this is so much fun. I love doing this. If you are a dab hand at alcohol ink as well, if you're good at using alcohol markers, it might be an option to color these with. But I'm trying it this way because this is the way that was recommended to me on the videos that I watched directly from Heartfelt Creations. So that's what I'm doing here. Here you can sort of see how it's going. I'm losing a bit of my contrast on the light parts though, so I'm not sure if I'm really doing myself any favors here. This pad is falling to bits as well because it's old. Flapping about. Just came off of having a really fun class on Monday with Discover Papercraft at the studio. We made party bags out of envelopes. That was a fun class. If you want to have a look at the pictures, the Unravel and Unwind Facebook page actually has an album called Discover Papercraft, so you can see what we've all been up to in class. There we go. So that is kind of, sort of, colored, sort of. And I've got to do this with a couple more flowers so that I can make the design. I think I will in future be using my alcohol ink markers. It's faster, I'm going to say. I mean, I've got the time to spend today, so that's good, but normally I think I might. And I've also got these great markers from Chameleon, and they make a gradation effect without having to use multiple pens. So I quite like, I would definitely be using those with this. Right, so that's my highlight color on. And my inner wisteria is coming out. Look at these. Now you might be wondering why I'm not coloring the centers. These flowers are going to be overlapped on each other, and that's where the glue is going to go. So also you're not going to see a great deal of that part of the flower. You're not going to see any of it really. This pad's just come unstuck. I'm about to get very, very messy. La la la. La la la. Okay. Ah. I don't know how to re-stick these ink pads, but look, it's come right off. Boom. So this might be the last time I use this. I'm really not sure how one would get that back on. Okay, and let's get our tips colored. Whoop, that's not the one. That's this one. I was like, that looks like it's already been done. Oh, this one's coming apart too. Oh man, I have to work quick and gently. Alright, so I've kind of got two sort of shaded and colored in ones anyway, and I'm going to do a third one. Is that smaller? It is. Okay. Smaller, you can kind of afford to... Whoops! Whoop! Yeah, that's it. I'm keeping you here. Gravity is going to keep that pad on there. This one is all right. This one's still okay. Kind of wish I hadn't started it using this now. Oh, dear. Squishing ink around. That's what's happening today. It's interesting because I got into all the ink because of rubber stamping, but I do find that I do a lot of this, which is direct to paper techniques, without using a stamp at all. Okay, let's see if I can just, yeah, get a little bit in there. Cool. Yeah, I'm just gonna... I love these ink pads though. I've been keeping them away from the light, keeping them out of the air as well, making sure they're covered up and kept somewhere closed, just so I can prolong the life of them. I bought them ages ago. I have had them for a long time and they've done me very well indeed. So if this is their death knell, I don't mind, because I got a lot out of them over the years. Okay, that's not quite blended. Let's see, blend it out a little bit. And then next time I do a flower, the next flower I do, I'm going to bring in my markers. Let's see if we can do this any faster. All right, so that's another one. And one more, just one more. So, just do that. This isn't how you'd ordinarily do it. Also, these color box, this brand, they make a small chalk ink pad called a cat's eye, which is like that, and they're kind of, you know, they're good for the direct to paper technique as well, and because the pad is very sponge-like, it works quite well. What color is this anyway? Something violet. I bet that's the same color. Look, it's the same color. It's warm violet. Oh, excellent. Okay, so I've already got this one in a smaller pad. Excellent. In that case, let's get... All right, now this one, oops, forgot the petal there, missed one out. This one is going to be the top visible layer of the flower, and I'm going to go in there and I'm going to put some flocking on it. Flocking is like a fuzzy, yellowy... Well, it's not always yellow. It's whatever color you want it to be, really. But it's a fuzzy stuff that sticks on with glue. And it will look like pollen in the middle of the flower. So I'm going to definitely do that. Sorry, I'm just finishing the shading on this one. Okay, so these are the little leftovers. We are going to do things with the little leftover ones, but for now, I'm just going to cover up my ink, and I'm going to take a little break and quickly run downstairs. If you need to get yourself another drink or something, please feel free to do it. I'm going to have a little BRB. I'm going to go for a few minutes and I'm going to come back. I'm not going to switch the stream off, but I am going to switch my microphone off, and I'll be back in a few minutes.